This is Maria Sue, and Maria is going to sing a song for you today and do a little dance, a little performance on the video blog just for you, our friends. All right? So, you ready, Maria? Here you go. Get on your stage. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Maria Sue Chapman. Oh, that's the crowd. Okay, they're ready. Go. You're on.
Yesterday, I was going through the internet and watching some home videos of Maria and just seeing the joy in her heart and how she was just beautiful. I was sitting there at my computer just gazing at her with just this big smile on my face, and she had so much life in her. And I'm so sorry for your loss. I'm so sorry that this happened to you. And I'm not a mother yet, but I know this story's gonna minister not only to families, but to mothers. And as a mother, tell me, what do you miss most about Maria?
The whole package. you know, as much joy as you saw on Maria's face, she could be that mad too. There wasn't a whole lot of in between with her. We used to, she was number six, and she was the perfect baby of the family. And so we knew we were finished at that point, because we thought we were finished after Caleb, and then four more came, Will, and then the whole adoption. But thank you so much. But there wasn't a whole lot of in between with her, and we figured that out pretty quick. She was the oldest of the adopted. When she came home, she was 15 months old, and we figured out pretty quickly in China. Okay, her governor, she goes from about 0 to 100. She didn't have a governor. And so when she got mad, she really, really got mad. And so there was a lot of, a lot of days of, what are we going to do with this? You know,
this is going to be
a passion that's going to need to be directed.
She's 13 and 16, if she has this much passion.
She was loud on both ends of the spectrum. She could throw a good fit, and they would last for a while. But so when I say I miss the whole package, you knew when she was in a room, either way, whether she was mad or happy, and funny, and but probably the thing, you know, when we first came home, obviously, the silence of not having her was what screamed the loudest, because she was the loudest of all of us. But her little sister, Stevie, is just 7 months older. So they were basically like twins. They shared a room. They dressed alike. And I think just to watch that whole process of three, now two, and then Shoei having to learn to interact with Stevie, and Stevie not knowing what to do because half of her's missing, because they did everything together as a mom. Mm. It's really tough. But the girls have done amazingly well. They miss her. But that's probably the thing, just watching the other two have to re-navigate. Mm-hmm. Probably has been the hardest. But
Mary Beth, you have just opened up your heart, and you're sharing your story, your heart as a mother, through your new book, mm-hmm. Choosing to See. Mm-hmm. What's the theme of that book?
Well, it's basically, I gave a speech at a church, and it, as I wrote it, I realized that my whole entire life has seemed to be a big wrestling match with God, and I don't know why, I just don't give up, but I mean, the theme is kind of my plan versus what really God had for me, and just kind of how I've kind of, just from the time I was a little girl, kind of bucked up against it and just, you know, just asked the questions and asked the hard questions, and yet still thought I knew, you know, what I wanted and what I thought was best, and, you know, maybe God needed the fourth member of the Trinity to, named Mary Beth, to help him out a little bit. But, you know, just the, as I looked back, as I wrote that speech, and then as I gave it, I went, okay, there's a kind of a theme here of I've kind of been wrestling with God my whole life. And I think it actually took, you know, the accident to bring me to a place, you know, the again, God always has us doing what we said we'd never do. And, you know, I say that a lot when I speak. I said I wouldn't adopt, I wouldn't homeschool, and I wouldn't ever speak in public. And so I've kind of thrown all that out, you know. Now I'm using reverse psychology, saying I won't go to Hawaii for 6 months and do nothing. I don't know if that's going to work.
No way.
I thought I might try. No. But as I was talking, you know, it kind of, and then out of the blogs, you know, again, I wasn't at the time a big blogger. Really, I maybe didn't even know what a blog was at that point. I'm not exactly sure.
I don't
but
think so.
Just kind of as the days passed after Maria, uh-huh. It wasn't like every day, but every so often I would just have this random thought and just kind of and go with it, more of a stream of consciousness kind of thing. And people really started responding to the grief, to the questions, to the wrestling, to all of it. And so as kind of all that evolved, they approached me, would you ever write this story, write this book? And it was real important for me that it wasn't just the story of Maria. While that in and of itself is a story, and it is a redemptive story and will be completely redemptive when we see clearly what Maria does, but right now we're looking through a dimly lit mirror or dark glass.
Yeah.
But, you know, just as, you know, as it evolved, I said, you know, this kind of is my whole life, you know, from the time I was a little girl being raised in a pretty legalistic environment and just the whole, you know, introduction of grace into my life later, and then just some of the things that happened to me in high school, and then eventually going to college and saying, that's it, I'm marrying an accountant, I need stable, I need stability, I need 9-to-5. Yeah, and, you know, so...
Not
the
an
theme,
accountant.
The theme is, you know, I, you know...
Not an accountant.
And definitely not 9-to-5.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
So took accounting in college.
There you go.
What I was
barely passed it, but other than that, no.
It took a creative God, because my maiden name is Chapman. For a lot of people who follow us know that, but my maiden name is Chapman, and it took me sharing a mailbox with him to meet him. So God's pretty creative that way. That's how we met. But you know, just the theme is just I had a plan, and no matter what that plan was, God had a better one. And even today, when I, you know, I look at Maria, you can't look at that situation by itself and go, that's a good plan from God, because then that sounds like, how cruel, how can, that's a cruel God for people who don't believe. How could you say that was good? Because it's not good. It's the enemy is at his worst. Now, can God do amazing things with it? Absolutely. But my whole life has been experiences of, you know, what will God do with this now? And then how will you share that story? And so it kind of became that Mary Beth versus God. That was kind of the working title of the book. And so that's kind of where it was born out of. That's where the book proposal was written, kind of from that speech. And so it kind of evolved from there.
Tell me about the title. Why the title, Choosing to See?
Well, it's a great title. And how we got there, how we got there was a long process, because there was a million titles. And I was at first really hesitant to use the word see. And to back up a little bit, when we went back to the house after the accident to get to gather up things we needed for the memorial service, some of the clothes we needed, some of the things of Maria's I wanted to have at the memorial service, my sweet husband and Caleb and Will had just been praying that God would really start to show up, and we really needed to see him working in the situation, because we were just putting one step in front of the other. Not, I mean, you know, obviously totally blindsided, and, you know, just, God, where are you? Are you, you know, all those questions that you ask, are you, is it now that we, you know, decide that we believe it all, or it's all a crock? I mean, you know, just wondering. And so their prayer was just, God, we have to see you. We have to see you. Please show us. Please show us. And he walked to Maria's. We have two little art tables in our dining room that the girls sat side by side doing art. And Maria loved to draw flowers. And he looked down, and there was a piece of paper on the art table, a notebook piece of paper, and there was on this side a flower. My, can't Well, he's got it tattooed on his arm, but it's really, yeah. So I think you should ask him. So, because it's her, he has her actual art. I just have like a kind of, it's a cleaned up version of it, but it was a flower and clearly not finished. It had six petals, and one of the petals was colored in blue, and then a little green stem with tulip leaves. And then he noticed that there was marker bleeding through the backside of the paper, so he flipped it over. And little orange butterfly that she drew right here, and then the word C, just right across the paper. And to our knowledge, Maria had not written. She could write her name. She could write, I love mommy, I love daddy. That was about it.
Yeah, pretty much. We have all the words she knew to write pretty much, over and over, because she wrote those four or five words.
Yeah, we had never seen her write that. And
what a gift that you were able to share the gospel with your little girl. Oh. And I want you to tell me how that feels.
Oh, I mean, again, it's one of those ordinary days that you're, you know, rushing around getting them ready for preschool. And just like you said, you know, she just real matter-of-factly just started asking me those questions one by one. And, you know, it didn't take me too long to catch on to what she was quoting. And so, you know, that's why I kind of jumped ahead of her. And she's, you know, just always remember that face. Mom, how did you know? And I said, Maria, are you, you know, learning this song? And she said, yes, we're learning it for preschool. And that's when she said, we kind of joke about this, but she said, that's when she said, I want to know how to go to God's big, big house. And so, probably the legalism in me or the whatever it is, I went, okay, let's go find dad. I don't mess anything up. So, you know, I was like, okay, you know, what do you do? Go find Stephen Curtis Chapman. He'll help you. Yeah. So I said, well, let's go.
Stephen, come here.
No,
Maria's asking some questions.
I just wanted to make sure she was so young. And, you know, but she was so exactly at her questions. I mean, we're exact. And that song, you know, really got her little mind thinking. And that Faith Like a Child verse just so comes to life because we talked to her about it. She believed it. I want to go there. I want to make sure I'm going there. And we had no idea it would be as soon as it was. But when she jumped down off that kitchen counter, and then Steve's the one that drove him that day, he walked him in that day and made sure that they were able to bear witness to that to their teachers. And she went bounding into her teacher, Miss Megan, and told Miss, she said, tell Miss Megan what you did today. And she said, I asked Jesus into my heart. And so it was just, again, one of those gifts that God gives you along the way to really hold on to know that she's there and she's telling us in all kinds of ways, I believe, that she's there.
And you said in your book, if that was God's plan for you to adopt her, bring her here so that you could share Jesus with her, because maybe he knew her life would be that short. Yeah. Can you tell me that in your own words?
Physical adoption here on this planet called Earth mirrors so much our spiritual adoption into the kingdom, and that we do have a name. He knows us by name, and he knows that, you know, everything about us and how weird we are and how good we are and how bad we are and all of that about us, because he adopted us and we're his. And so in light of our adoption journey, that's been a goal, that we're not just adopting these children to be in the dysfunctional Chapman household at times. We are adopting these children with the hope that they will be adopted into the kingdom, and therefore the ongoing work in China. I mean, obviously, children in China have an opportunity at some level to receive Christ. I think it becomes less likely in a communist country. So by bringing our children here into a Christian home, our, you know, goal was that they would meet Christ and have a profound relationship with him. And who knew that Maria would get to be first?
As a parent, what kind of hope does it give you to know that even though you miss her every day, you will see her again?
Huh. I mean, I cannot fathom walking through what we've walked through, especially having other children involved, because it's the worst case scenario in either way. Had that just happened with Will with another family, that would have been horrible. Had that just happened to Maria with a stranger driving a car, would have been horrible. But you kind of have both, which makes it doubly hard to know and be confirmed beyond a shadow of a doubt that we have the hope we will see her again. And there's days that I feel guilty. It's like, I can't wait to see Maria, because I'm like, all right, I'm supposed to long to see Jesus first. But like, I'm bypassing, you know, like, hey, take me to meet, you know, take me to Jesus. But that's a mom. That's the heart of a mom. So I know he understands you, so, that. Yeah.
And Paul says it, if our hope is only for this life, to get all those things to sort of line up, the planets to line up so things go pretty well with us, he said, we're really missing the whole heart of the gospel. And he says, we're really foolish if we believe that. We're to be pitied, he says in Scripture, because our hope is beyond this life. Our hope is so much greater and so much more, and it's what sustains us through the very valley of the shadow of death, to say, but that day is coming when he's going to wipe every tear from our eyes, when he's going to make all things new. And we anchor to that hope, so that when the storm comes, when the hurricane, when the tsunami hits, that we say, this is our anchor, this is our hope. It transcends, it's beyond this life and this these moments that we have here, that some, many of them are just moments to be endured, but we can endure them because of that hope. And even when they're the good moments, we still know it's not the ultimate, it's not all there is, because we know those moments come and then they go. They're fleeting, but the eternal hope that we have because of the love of God for us through Christ is what we are anchored to and what has sustained us through this.
What would you say to a parent who's lost their child but doesn't have any hope?
Well, the first thing I would say is I'm so, so sorry mm-hmm. for your loss, because the loss of a child. I remember my grandmother telling me when I was 13 years old, when my aunt passed away with cancer, that is just not natural to bury one of your children. And so I'm so, so sorry. But there is hope. I have been under my bed. I've been in my closet. I've cried and screamed and shaken my fist. Mm-hmm. And every time there is a voice and there's an answer, and that's from the one that can give hope. And that's Jesus Christ. And we have experienced it at a profound, profound level. Mm. It has come at a great cost, and I'm not going to pretend to even understand the depths of all that goes into losing a child and how God shows up and all of that. But I would say that there is hope. There's hope for you. And it's just really reaching out to the only one that can give hope, and that's Jesus. And that's what I would say mm-hmm. From a father's point of view.
Well, I mean, we have held on to the hand of the God of all comfort, and the Scripture calls him that, and we have found him to truly be that. He has comforted us, and we know can and will comfort you. The comfort doesn't always come the way we want to demand it. Boy, that's we have right. demanded God, if we don't have it right now, we are going to die. And we felt that. And when we feel like we've just breathed our last breath, God has breathed breath back into us and life into us. And he has been faithful. He will be faithful. There is a day coming when he will wipe every tear from our eyes. He never wastes a single tear. That's another thing we've learned. He doesn't waste this hurt. He doesn't waste your tears. He doesn't have his fingers in his ears, as it may seem sometimes. God, where are you? Why are you not listening to me? He is listening. He's hearing. And he is a God of all comfort. And we pray that you'll know him to be that. You'll put your faith in him, and you'll trust him. And you'll find him to be enough. You'll find his grace to be enough for you, as we've found that to be for us.
And I think it's important also to remember the cross, because mm-hmm. we can't enjoy. I remember our first Christmas without Maria. We couldn't enjoy Christmas without the reality that Easter was coming, because that's in essence the gospel. I mean, God knows what it is like to put his son to death for us. I mean, he did it for us. He was blameless. And so we were talking about a God who sacrificed his son for you and for us. And so that's the ultimate hope, is that we follow in that. We follow the cross of Christ. And that is it's a hard journey. It's a hard faith. It's a hard hope. But the reality is that that's what he's asked us to do, is to pick up our cross and follow him. And the cross that we are bearing is not the one we wanted. And but we're going to drag it and lug it all the way home, and that's eternity. And so that's what I again would remind everybody, that he's not unfamiliar with losing a child. I mean, he gave his son for us, for me, for you, for Maria.